You know, I forgot I still had my mask on. Do you ever start talking with it on?
I tried to eat food one time with it on.
How'd that go?
Not well. I had to clean the mask.
Stringer. Well, good morning, everybody. Really? Good morning? Okay. We're all here. Okay, good. Good to see you again. We're going to begin today with the passage from Psalms, Psalm 47 in its entirety. Clap your hands, all you peoples. Shout to God with a jubilant cry. For the Lord Most High is awe-inspiring, a great king over all the earth. He subdues peoples under us and nations under our feet. He chooses for us our inheritance, the pride of Jacob, whom he loves. God ascends amid shouts of joy, the Lord amid the sound of trumpets. Sing praise to God, sing praise. Sing praise to our King, sing praise. Sing a song of instruction, for God is King of all the earth. God reigns over the nations, God is seated on his holy throne. The nobles of the peoples have assembled with the people of God of Abraham. The leaders of the earth belong to God. He is greatly exalted. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning in the name of your Son, Jesus. You are the Almighty God. You are our Sovereign. And it is so comforting to remember that no matter what's going on around us, that you are indeed on the throne. Thank you today for the privilege of coming to this place to assemble openly to give you worship and praise. And we continue to pray for our current situation and for the health of our loved ones, and just that you will continue to help us to keep our focus on you and to glorify you no matter the circumstances. Please bless the pastor this morning as he brings us your word and your message. Use him to your glory and open our minds and our hearts so that we will hear and that we will understand and that we will do your will. All this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, despite everything, we are ready to sing. So if you're standing as we get started.
You live, you die, you said in 3 days you would rise, you did, you're alive. You rule, you reign, you said you're coming back again. I know you will, all the earth all the earth will sing your praises. I will
I'm going to get there in a minute. The button's in my pocket somewhere. Okay, are we on? Good. We are still trying to adjust to things being done differently. And so if we are scrambling a little bit up here, it's because we're scrambling a little bit up here. And anyway, I'm glad that you're here. I'm glad that we're all able to be here and enjoy being together. And we will continue to adjust as we need to, but, you know, that's just life. This is a big one, but life includes changes. I think back to the time of the early believers that they were coming out of Judaism, and as they were trying to figure out what the church was going to do, they couldn't keep meeting and have all their needs met in the temple. I mean, that was good because they were Jews, but it wasn't everything they needed. And for the Gentiles, that didn't work at all, the ones that came to Christ in the Gentile world. And so they started meeting in homes, and the church had to grow out of all of that. But it was a time of massive change. People had to change their way of thinking, of how they met together, how they worshiped. We're doing that now. We're adjusting. We're changing. And sometimes change is frustrating and difficult, sometimes a little bit painful. But God can use it to nudge us to do things we wouldn't do otherwise. And so my prayer, and I hope you'll be praying with me, is that as we continue to go through changes, as we're making adjustments for life now, I'm praying that God's going to wake us up spiritually in some new ways, and that we will respond to him at new depths and new levels, that we will be able to carry his message to this world in new ways that we haven't before because we were complacent. We didn't have to move, have to change. And so change can be a good thing, even though it is a little bit uncomfortable and it makes us scatter and figure out on the go what we got to do sometimes, but it's a good thing. So all of that said, this is the greeting time. Welcome. Glad that you're here. Glad that you are taking the time to be with us physically. And we will be posting this. I'm recording so that it will be posted on our Facebook later in the day. So it's not the live feed. We've just had too many technical issues with that. But if you have a friend that would like to catch our services, we are trying to get everything recorded and uploaded later in the day on our Facebook. But thank you so much for being here today, and let's continue to pray that God will work, that God will use this day to His glory, to His power. Now let's go into our prayer time, and we typically have the QR code to scan. We're not doing that right now just because of social distancing, but you are still welcome to give us your prayer request, and we will pray together right now for those requests. You are well. You don't have to be a member of Calvary to give us your request. You could just be passing through today, but everyone is welcome. What we'll do is, if you want to say your request, then Warren will come and hold the microphone for you. Please don't hold the mic. Just let Warren hold it close to your mouth and tell us what your request is, and we will see how that works this week. So do you have anything you would like us to pray with you about today? I will get us started. One thing, our oldest son, Charlie, is in the military in the U.S. as a U.S. Marine, and he's not being called up for deployment, but he does have a couple of weeks coming up of annual training, and so that will be extra for him, and of course means he'll be away from the home with his wife, Mallory, and our grandson, CJ. So please be praying for all of that. And he was also, this weekend, Charlie was not feeling well. And you can continue to pray for my wife to come back to Thailand. I think Emmy has one. Emmy? So for the refugee ministry? Yeah, it's not coming through strongly, a little bit. It's on, it's just not strong.
But yes, it's just a refugee ministry and also for the family for their salvation.
Yeah, we've been praying for her family salvation a long time, Fuchs family salvation, Greg and John Hargrove. So quite a number that we want to pray for their family to come to know Christ. Okay, here's one with Nook. Yeah, have to be strong. And these are patients of yours, Nook? Okay. I think I got it. Yeah. To finances and, yeah. And, of course, as Nook continues to share the truth, gospel with them. Okay, so what I think I heard, and you guys correct, but pray for the people that are still in IDC because there is some bail, but they can't get enough to put it together for the bail, so we need to pray for them.
Right.
Okay.
Because they up the charge.
Oh, the bail has been increased.
Yeah.
Oh, it's expensive already. Okay. Okay. There, Jacob.
One of my
brother-in-law. Okay. In Pakistan. Okay. Oh, Chantel over here. I'm wondering if that's travel plans. Although we like keeping you here, Chantel. Oh, okay. We knew that day was coming. So leaving on Tuesday. So we need to pray for Mookie, who's still having difficulty. And the others, I couldn't quite hear. Okay, Anthony. And his mother, okay. Yeah, don't hold it, yeah. Okay, so we can certainly pray that God's truth will prevail as the Thai government is looking at the possibility of same-sex marriages. Okay. And any update on Lynn? Same basic things for Lynn. Pray for his...
Same basic things. I mean, you know, recently I've noticed just an improvement in his outlook. He seems to be a bit more positive. That was the biggest thing that actually concerned me because, as I said, his condition is not severe. You know, it impairs him from doing certain things. Like it's very difficult for him to write now, but he still, you know, he still has the use of his hands.
Okay.
Pretty strong. But the biggest thing is just that, you know, the emotional toll, the depression that set in.
Yeah.
You know, didn't want to do stuff. So that part is improving. The condition is pretty much the same for the last year and a half. But I think I'm hoping that he's turning the corner.
Okay. Good.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right, let's pray. Father, it is such a comfort to know that we can come in prayer. Some of the things we've mentioned today are really deeply serious things. I mean, thinking about little Mookie, a 9-year-old boy that's battling cancer, battling for his life quite literally, and to imagine what the whole family is going through right now, those things are just so overwhelming because it reminds us that we have so little control over life. Some days we feel like we've got things going well and that we can control it, that we can direct where we go and what we do. But then other things happen and remind us that ultimately we really are not in control. And that can be terrifying. And yet we need to be reminded that you are the God who is greater than any kind of illness we ever face, any kind of crisis that will ever strike our lives or our families or our friends. You are greater than any of it. And I'm grateful that we have stories like Job, that even though he went through suffering, you were there faithfully with him, watching over him, and reminding him ultimately that you are in control of everything that happens somehow. And God, since you are a good God, you are a loving God, and a merciful and graceful, just God, we trust you to work things out well. And so we ask that you will please continue to be with Mookie's family to help him work your healing in his body and help them all to learn to trust you at some new levels as they go through some extremely difficult times. course, we've also been praying for Anthony. I ask that you'll continue to provide for him and help him and his mom, and of course, for Chantel's family. A lot of needs have been coming up there that we want to continue to pray for and to support her, and certainly to pray for Chantel as she heads back to be with her family. We ask that you will guide the travel to be good. These are very uncertain times, but you are greater than the airline companies and the connections that are made and the luggage that's carried. We pray for those practical things that you will help Chantel have a good trip and be able to get back and be an encouragement and help to her family. We ask that you'll just continue to be with Emmy's family to watch over them. We prayed a lot for her dad, for you to help him with his health. But more importantly, we're praying for his salvation, her mom's salvation, other family members and friends, that as Emmy continues to have opportunity, help her to share your love and work in the hearts of the ones that in her family to help them to respond to that. And we're going to continue to do that also for ones in other families that we have here in our church. Ask that you will work to reach these families and show them your love. And Father, we ask that you'll just continue to be with Noak as she shares her faith with her patients, and that you will work in the patients' lives to provide for their needs, but to provide in ways that will show you are the one doing it. We want you to receive the glory and the honor. And so we ask that you will do that. And Father, we ask that you'll continue to work in our asylum seeker refugee communities that we work with. We ask that you will help them to make ends meet, that you will meet their needs one way or another as they have lost little opportunities that they had to begin with of work, and that things are even more difficult. But we ask that you'll be with the ones in IDC to watch over, protect them in their health and in their emotions, and to help the ones that can get the bail together so that they can work it out to get out of IDC. We ask that you'll please be with Jacob's brother-in-law and family back in Pakistan, that you'll just continue to watch over them and provide and protect. God, we've had a lot of friends go back to Pakistan and know that it is a difficult and dangerous place for people of faith, but you still are greater than any of the terrorism or persecution that we'll ever face. And we ask that you will continue to provide and watch over them. And we ask that you will be with the other requests that we've mentioned this morning, Father God. We've had some others of needs in different ways. And though we may not voice every single request right now, you have heard each one. You hear our hearts as we come to you, as we ask you to work and lead and guide and answer these things the way that you know us best. But God, ultimately, we just need to know that that you're there. We need to grow deeper in our faith and trust of you so that no matter what happens in this life, we can stand firm and trust in you. And Father, now we're going to go into the time of the message. And I ask that you will work to help us all hear what you have to say. This is your time. You know, you're going to use me, I pray, to speak it clearly. But Father, it's not about me. It's not about our church. It's not about anything here. It's about you, about your truth, about you being at work. And that is what we want. We want you to declare your greatness today, to declare your love to us, to declare the ways that we need to adjust our lives to you. Father, as we go into this time of message, help us simply hear what you are saying. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's go ahead and do the offering. Yeah, here's another adjustment. We're going to do the offering now, but I just prayed for our message, and so let's have the offering. And if you have someone that will pray for the offering, that would be great. Sure.
Can we have some volunteers to help the offering as well? Thank you all for your flexible, you know, spontaneous flexibility.
Remind them to not take the bag.
Oh, right. So I think all of you guys were here last week, so we're keeping the bag and not passing it, and people are just dropping it. Okay. All right. Great. Thank you. And let's pray. Heavenly Father, we recognize that you have given us everything that we have. You have given us life. You provide for us. You call us to a greater purpose, but you also provide for each and every daily need. We cannot count the blessings that you have given to us. And at this point, as an act of worship and in our gratitude and our thankfulness to you, we want to take this time to offer back a small portion of what you've given to us. And my prayer is that your spirit, your wisdom will guide the church in using this offering, that you will multiply it and help us to use it to provide for needs and also to just to bring the gospel message to everyone that we possibly can, because that's what you've called us to do. And all this we ask in Jesus' name.
Just as one quick informational update to encourage you, this week, hopefully, we're supposed to begin work Tuesday on a new sound system in here. And actually, today, it sounds pretty good. So that figures. When we're getting ready to get rid of it, it's going to start working right. But we're going to have the teams, they're supposed to come in Tuesday, take maybe about 2 days to get that done. Now, that's going to be a process, I'm sure, for us to get used to it, change the location of the control center to the back. And in the process, it won't be right away, but we're also going to add 2 more TVs, hopefully, to be able to increase the visibility of everything so that if you struggle in the top or back, hopefully you'll be able to see better soon. So we're working out those details, and I'm sure there's going to be some unknown things come up, but hopefully starting next Sunday, we will start testing the new sound system and see how it works. I'm anxious to do all of that, so please be praying for that. Some of you have heard me mention I have an older brother. And a few years ago, he retired from a career as an insurance adjuster, but he has never been one to travel a lot. I'm the one in the family that's been all over the world, and he usually tried to stay pretty close to home. Well, after he retired, he went out west in the United States to visit one of his sons who had moved to New Mexico. We call it travel bug. But he found that traveling away from home is actually fun, and he enjoyed that. And, of course, if you know the term redneck, he is a redneck. And so any of the aura of the guns and fighting of the West, the guns, he just loves that. And so with his son, one of his sons being out there already and just falling in love with the West, he has moved out to New Mexico, to Albuquerque. Now, one of the things that he has really enjoyed about Albuquerque, he and his wife, is that every year now since 1972, Albuquerque has the Albuquerque International Balloon Fiesta. Now, the balloons that they have aren't the little balloons on a string like you get at the restaurants and stuff. These are the great big hot air balloons that have the basket underneath that people ride in, so you can go way up in the air and float around under the big hot air balloon. Well, this festival is the largest hot air balloon in the world. They run it for 9 days every year in October and have almost 1 million visitors come to Albuquerque. And they have well over 500 balloons that are always showcased. So there's rides that you can get, activities, and I'm sure contests of different types. It is just a lot of fun. Now, I don't know about you. I like heights. I have always wanted to go up in a hot air balloon or to do the hang gliders, that kind of thing. But the cheap side of me that doesn't want to pay the big dollars has refused to do it. But I would love to someday to do the hot air balloons, because to me it just seems like such a cool idea in the quietness, because there's no engine. You just hear the burners creating the hot air to make the balloon go up. But to just silently ride floating on the air currents just to me seems like the coolest thing to do. Now, hot air balloons are very different from airplanes. You know, the hot air balloon is the lighter than aircraft. An airplane is not lighter than air. And the aircraft have the controls. They can go anywhere they want. You can steer an airplane. You cannot steer, or basically you can't steer, a hot air balloon. I did a little bit of quick research this week and did find out that experienced pilots know about air currents. And apparently there are different levels of air currents according to the height or the altitude. And so sometimes the air current will be faster on one level than another level, or it may be in a slightly different direction. And so that is the only element of steering that the hot air balloon pilot has. If he can find the right level and it goes in a little bit different direction, he can do that. But obviously, it's not going to be like, oh, I'm wanting to go back here, so let's turn around. You don't do that with a hot air balloon. You basically go wherever the air current takes you. Today, we're going to be talking about people with a weak will, particularly looking at Pilate as Jesus was going through the next set of trials we began looking at last week with the Jews, now this week with Pilate. And Pilate was kind of like a hot air balloon in that hot air balloons just have to follow the air current wherever the air takes them. A person with a weak will, like Pilate, follows along with the crowd. They don't want to create problems. They, for one reason or another, go along with whatever the crowd wants. So we're going to look at that this morning. Now, last week, as we looked at the Jewish leaders, we looked at the idea of hard hearts and that Jesus, you know, Jesus was God in human form. He came, he preached the truth, he taught the truth, he lived it. I mean, he did amazing miracles, and the Jewish leaders could not deny the miracles. But despite the fact that God was in human form in front of them, they would not acknowledge Jesus as the Messiah, because in that drift away from God, their hearts had become hardened to the point no amount of truth could get through to them any longer. So that's what we looked at last week. This week, as we look at Pilate, we're going to see that idea. He had a very weak will. And as we think about having a weak will and look at the example of Pilate, two things come out that cause people to have, or maybe don't cause them to have the weak will, but there are two things that are the result of people having a weak will. And one is a violation of your conscience. That when you have a weak will, you will violate what you know to be right and wrong. And the other one is a willingness to compromise. And we're going to see both of those things in Pilate as we go through this next phase of Jesus' trials. And we'll just try to see how it is that we can apply those ideas of a weak will to us. So hopefully we will avoid having a weak will like Pilate. Well, let's take a look. We're going to begin in John chapter 18, verses 28 through 32. And this is just the beginning point. You might call it the jumping off point. It's where we begin our journey this morning. Because to get the big picture of Jesus's trial only just before Pilate, much less, you know, he's already been to Annas, the father-in-law of Caiaphas. And from Annas, he went to Caiaphas and the Sanhedrin, and now to Pilate. So for each one of those parts of his trials, you have to look at all of the gospel messages together, because each one gives a little different perspective. John gives us the most about Pilate. The others don't mention much about Pilate compared to John. So John gives us a little bit better insight, but not all of it. So this is our starting point, John 18, 28 through 32, that'll just get us into the story. Then we'll have to look at some others to put together the big picture. So let me encourage you to do that when you're reading through the stories of the New Testament and you want to get that bigger picture. You need to look at, for the Gospels, each one and see, is this story recorded in each Gospel, and what are the differences that I can get out of that? Good Bible study approach. Anyway, we'll finally get to the Bible passage. Here it is. Then they led Jesus from Caiaphas to the governor's headquarters. It was early morning. They did not enter the headquarters themselves, otherwise they would be defiled and unable to eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said, "What charge do you bring against this man?" They answered him, "If this man weren't a criminal, we wouldn't have handed him over to you." Pilate told them, "You take him and judge him according to your law." "It's not legal for us to put anyone to death," the Jews declared. They said this so that Jesus' words might be fulfilled, indicating what kind of death he was going to die. So as we look at this, again, Jesus has already been through two phases of trials. He's been with Annas, then with Caiaphas and the Sanhedrin. And we're seeing some interesting insights already just into what is happening. Because the Jews admittedly didn't have the full authority to execute anyone. Now, you may say, well, what about Stephen? They stoned Stephen a little bit later on. Actually, some of them in other places did stone Paul, but Paul lived through it. So what we see when we put together the facts of history and what the scripture's telling us is that the Romans apparently gave the Jewish people a little bit of leeway with that. They would overlook some of the stonings, but they were the sole controllers of crucifixion. And so the Jews here, and interestingly, according to what Jesus had said would be fulfilled, the Jews did not want Jesus to be stoned. Now, they weren't trying to fulfill any prophecies. They thought they were just killing off a problem person. But Jesus knew that very act of the Jews not wanting to stone him, which they probably could have gotten away with, but they wanted something worse. They wanted something more public, more criminal. They wanted this man on display. They wanted the Romans to crucify him so he would suffer and they would finally be done with him. And they could not do that. They did not have the power. So that's why they took him to Pilate. Otherwise, they probably would have just left after Caiaphas and the Sanhedrin, taken him out and stoned him to death. But scripture will always, always be fulfilled. And not a bone of his body was broken. So let's take a look at this whole idea of people with a weak will like Pilate. How does a weak will reveal itself in our life? That's the question we want to begin with. Well, first of all, we see it coming out as a violation of conscience, that we know the right thing to do, but we're still willing to violate that in some way or another. Now, again, you have to look at all of the gospel accounts to put together the whole picture of Pilate and his interaction both with the Jews and with Jesus, because it was back and forth quite a bit. I don't think it took very long, considered all the events of that day, but there was a lot of back and forth where he was with Pilate, and you know, Pilate would talk to the Jews, and Pilate would talk to Jesus. And we'll see in a minute, Pilate even handed Jesus off at one point to King Herod. So there was a lot of back and forth, a lot of opportunity for Pilate to talk to Jesus and the Jews. But when we put it all together, put together the entire story, Pilate's actions show he repeatedly violated his own conscience. He knew from the start, as soon as he started talking to the Jews and interrogating Jesus, he knew Jesus was not worthy of what he was being condemned of by the Jews. Now, Jesus at this point was still in the early morning hours. The Jews had done most of their trials during the nighttime, actually during the dark, which we have seen before was fitting since they had the hard hearts, and darkness was their time, the time of evil, which they would have denied completely, but because they were so far from God, it was their time, their dominion, as Jesus would call it. But at that point, Caiaphas, the current high priest, and the Sanhedrin had decided, yeah, we need to get rid of this guy. He is worthy of death. Let's send him to the Romans. It is now the early morning hours, and Jesus is taken to the Romans. And of course, we had the little bit of a note. Since we're coming up close to the Sabbath, the Jews could not go into the pagan area of this Roman leader. So Pilate had to actually come out to them. And so Pilate talks with the Jews, and you see some animosity already. You know, Pilate saying, well, you know, what charges do you have against him? And the Jews just kind of answer, well, he's got to be guilty if we've taken him to you. That's kind of the attitude that's behind that conversation. And so Pilate leaves them and goes in and talks to Jesus, begins his interrogation. After the initial interrogation, he realized already Jesus was not guilty of any serious crime. From the start, you can see Pilate already knows Jesus doesn't deserve what they say he deserves. And so from that standpoint, as you start to follow the story through, and keep in your mind the idea that Pilate repeatedly violated his conscience in all of this, you can find three times for certain that it is recorded on at least three occasions Pilate clearly said he found no grounds to charge Jesus. Three times at least, minimum. I mean, that's what's recorded. And it tells us he spent a lot of other effort trying to clear Jesus. And yet, Jesus still ended up being crucified. Pilate clearly violated his own conscience. And another point that we see of Pilate violating his conscience is what he saw in the Jews. He realized that the Jews wanted Jesus crucified because of jealousy. There wasn't a real charge. That was just made up. That was to hide the fact that the Jews were jealous. Take a look in Mark chapter 15, verse 10. This is Pilate. It is describing Pilate said, for he knew it was because of envy that the chief priests had handed him over. So keep in mind, Pilate is the governor of this region there in Judea. So he's already had ample opportunities to work with the Jewish leaders. He knows these guys. He knows the politics that's going on in the Jewish life. And he knows that these men want to hold on to their power. They don't like it that Jesus has come along and he's been gathering crowds. Now, surely, if Pilate is a sound leader of that region, and everything we have from history seems to tell us he was a strong leader, he would have known about this one man that was able to gather such large crowds. Do you remember, just to kind of bring it in perspective, do you remember how many people Jesus was able to gather on the day that he fed the 5,000 men? That was just the beginning point. What is the final number that was a possible number of people Jesus taught that day? Does anybody remember? It was a lot more than 5,000. Anybody want to give it a guess? The total number, because it didn't, that 5,000 does not include women or children. Keep going up. Possibly as many as 20,000. I think likely in the neighborhood of 15 to 20,000 people. Jesus was able to gather thousands of people on numerous occasions. The Romans wanted to maintain control. They would have known anyone that was able to gather that kind of crowd. Pilate would have known about Jesus, and being a good leader of that region and protecting his own interest, he would have known about the tensions rising between the Jewish leaders and Jesus. And so he knew these guys don't have a real charge against Jesus. They just want to get rid of him. They're jealous that he's getting so much power and control, and they don't. But knowing that didn't change the course of what Pilate ultimately did. And then add to that his wife, because his wife begged him to have nothing to do with Jesus. Now, Matthew is the only one that gives us this insight, but notice what Matthew tells us in 27, verse 19. While he was sitting on the judge's bench, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with that righteous man, for today I've suffered terribly in a dream because of him." I mean, this is Pilate's wife. She's basically saying, "Husband, I don't know what's going on here, but what I know is I've had a nightmare about this guy, and I am begging you, do not get involved. Hand it off. Get rid of it any way you can. Do not be involved with this man. It's going to be trouble. It's going to be a problem. Get away from it." Even that Pilate didn't listen to. Of course, we all husbands know we always listen to our wives. Right, husbands? Husbands saying yes, wives are saying, "What?" Selective hearing, is that what it is, guys? Pilate did not listen to his wife that day. He knew Jesus did not deserve to be executed, but he still would not honor that. But most of all, and I think this is the final point that we see Pilate break and honestly, truly, deeply violate his conscience, is that most of all, Pilate struggled with truth. Go back to John chapter 18, verses 37 through 38. And this is in the conversation again as Pilate is interrogating Jesus. And you know, part of the charge that the Jews are bringing is that he is raising up this rebellion against us and against Rome. You know, he wants to be a king. And so Pilate is digging, trying to get some information about that. But notice what it says. "You are a king then," Pilate asked. "You say that I'm a king," Jesus replied. "I was born for this, and I've come into the world for this, to testify to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice." "What is truth?" said Pilate. Now, there have been a lot of studies and sermons and things done on Pilate, in fact, on his statement here. And in fact, I have been one of those to do that. But we have to, if we're honest, tell you, we really don't know exactly what Pilate meant by that. Because it could just be sarcasm. "Oh yeah, well, what is truth?" Or it could be Pilate was genuinely searching for truth. He wanted to know what the truth was. So that's not the important part of the passage. What is important is what Pilate learned from Jesus. And this helped him completely understand that really this guy isn't guilty of anything deserving death, because he is not trying to be a political king or a military king. Now that would be a danger. And I can guarantee Pilate and the Romans would have gone after that. But that's not the kind of king Jesus is saying. He says, "My kingdom is basically one of truth. I'm coming to show people what the truth is." And of course, that's where Pilate says, "Well, what is truth?" But Pilate knew, this guy is not a threat to us. That's not the kind of kingdom he is setting up. But he did not honor in his own life what he knew to be the truth. So let's think about it for ourselves. Let's, as we think about violating conscience as a result of a weak will. How do we apply that to our lives? What do we need to see in us? And how can we learn from that? Well, just a simple basic statement that you need to hear is this. Violating our conscience is a dangerous thing to do. Now, I say that and that it's a basic statement, but it's amazing how many times we do violate our conscience and yet think, well, this is just a small thing. It's not really a big deal, and it's, you know, it's just me. It's not going to hurt anybody else. It's not going to affect anybody else. And it's just going to be this one time. But it's like we've talked about sin. There is no sin that before God is a little sin and insignificant and willing to be ignored. Any sin we commit is an affront to the holiness of God. Any sin we commit has helped drive Jesus to the cross. Anytime we violate our conscience, when we do something we know is wrong, we sin. And it helped drive Jesus to the cross. So we need to be reminded, sin is ugly. That seems to be a theme that's been coming up recently, at least for me. The deadliness and destruction of sin. Violating your conscience is a highly dangerous thing to do. Now, your conscience speaks to you through guilt sometimes. And guilt is meant to drive us to repentance. You know, guilt is that idea I begin to feel uncomfortable, unsettled, feel bad because I've done something wrong and I know it's wrong. We all know what guilt is. It's meant to drive us back to God. That's God put it there. God made us so that we would experience guilt. That is our conscience speaking. But here's the danger. Ignoring guilt takes us deeper into sin and self-destructive behavior. Now, we typically will not think of it that way. When I am making one of those violations of my conscience, when I know I'm about to do something that's wrong, I don't typically think, well, I'm going to really pay the price for that eventually. We don't think of it that way because that comes back to the whole idea sin is tempting because it looks so good. It looks like something good is going to come to me because of this thing. You know, it's just a little thing, but I'm going to really have fun right now, or I'm going to make a lot of money right now, or I'm going to really get even with that person right now. You know, we can just keep going down the line of things that violate the right and wrong that we know in our conscience is right and wrong. But ultimately, any violation of conscience is destructive. And not just destructive, but it's self-destructive. It is something I am bringing on myself. I may think it's not going to hurt anybody, that it won't hurt me, but you can be assured, sin brings destruction to self and others. And the thing is that the more we ignore our conscience, the less we know and apply God's truth. If I am repeatedly just pushing down that conscience, speaking in my mind, telling me, this is the wrong thing to do, don't do it. And then I do it over here, something else. This is the wrong thing to do, don't do it. And I still do it. I'm pushing that conscience down. I am ignoring the guilt that's speaking, trying to make me get right with God. The more I do that, the less time I'm going to spend with God, the less time I'm going to spend knowing God's truth, and the less I am going to be likely to apply it to my life. Because the more I push that voice of God down that is speaking in my heart and my mind, the less I'm going to hear Him speak. And that's a dangerous, dangerous, terrifying place to be. But you know, it doesn't happen overnight, typically. We make little decisions all along the way. Each one, yeah, in the bigger scheme of things, that one decision really was not a big thing. That violation of my conscience, yeah, it wasn't anything huge. It's not like I went out and killed anybody. But you start to put those things together. And you find after a while, man, I've gone a whole lot farther than I ever would have thought I would go. I'm a lot farther from God than I ever thought I would be. Because it begins with those little steps, pushing God away, not listening to that voice of God working in us. And the thing is an active conscience reflects the work of the Holy Spirit in our life. When I am listening to God speaking, the Holy Spirit's going to work and do even more and keep growing and keep developing. I'm going to hear Him more clearly. I'm going to apply His truth more accurately. It will be better for me and everybody around me. And the opposite is true when I am pushing that voice away, when I am ignoring my conscience like Pilate, it's going to be self-destructive and it's going to hurt the people around me eventually. Guarantee it. So violation of conscience is one of the ways that we see a weak will lived out, but also a willingness to compromise. And that is absolutely clear in Pilate here. As we see this in Pilate, we see that Pilate tried to satisfy both sides by compromising the truth. He wanted to satisfy the Jews, and he wanted to satisfy his Roman leaders. You know, because Pilate was an important man, very powerful man, but he wasn't the top man. He had to answer to other people that were more powerful than him, and ultimately to Caesar himself. Pilate had to answer to a lot of people. And he was trying to compromise and please both sides. Well, when there's a right and a wrong, you can't please both. You've got to come down somewhere and say, this is the right or the wrong. But compromise says, no, let's bend that. Let's change it. Because we don't want to be all the way over here, but we don't want to be all the way over here either. That's compromise. And Pilate tried to do that. He tried to appease the Jews. He tried to appease his superiors. Now, notice the first thing that we see Pilate trying to do. When Jesus was handed over to him, and we looked at that trial process beginning, and Pilate began to interrogate Jesus, he found out where Jesus was from. And where do we know Jesus was from? What was he known as? What? Yeah, the Nazarene. He was from Nazareth. He was from the northern part of the country. And as Pilate began his interrogation, he began to realize, well, wait a minute. Jesus is in Herod's jurisdiction. Ah, Herod's in town. Let me just get rid of this problem, and I'm going to hand Jesus off to Herod and let Herod deal with it. Well, let's take a look at that. Luke 23, verses 13 through 16. Pilate called together the chief priests, the leaders, and the people, and said to them, "You have brought me this man as one who misleads the people. But in fact, after examining him in your presence, I have found no grounds to charge this man with those things you accuse him of. Neither has Herod, because he sent him back to us. Clearly, he has done nothing to deserve death. Therefore, I will have him whipped and then release him." Don't you love it when your plans to settle something come right back in your lap? Pilate thought, oh man, good, I'm done with this. I don't have to deal with this. It's going to be Herod's problem. And so Jesus was sent to Herod. I don't know if you remember Jesus before Herod. Jesus wouldn't even talk. He didn't answer Herod. He didn't have anything to say. Didn't defend himself. Didn't do anything. So Herod interrogated and mocked and abused him for a while, then sent him back to Pilate. Pilate didn't get rid of him. So that didn't work. But did you notice the last verse, 16? "Therefore, I will have him whipped and then release him." But you did hear the part just before. I don't find any grounds in this man to find him guilty. And yet, compromise. He had Jesus flogged in order to satisfy the crowd. He didn't deserve it. He didn't deserve anything. He was being charged with these wrong charges because of the Jews' jealousy. Pilate knew that. And yet, well, I'll tell you what. These Jews want some blood. They want to see something happen. So if I give them some blood, maybe they'll let it go and I can release Jesus. course, the thing is, if you know anything about flogging, it was not unusual for a person to die from the flogging. It was that severe that they would lose so much flesh and so much trauma to their body that they would often die from the flogging. So there was a chance Jesus could die from that. He didn't, but it didn't satisfy the crowd. They were still pushing for the crucifixion. So the next step, he released Barabbas. Now, if you remember who Barabbas was a known rebel leader and murderer. So here, I think, is Pilate's reasoning. Okay, the flogging didn't work. They got blood. They still want more. They still want this guy crucified. So we've got Barabbas. This is a bad guy. I mean, he is. He's been leading insurrections. He's committed murder. He's getting ready to be crucified. But then we've got this guy over here who is a righteous guy. The Jews are just envying him, but he's not a bad guy. He's a good man, teaching good things. So if I put these two up before the public, surely the crowds are going to choose the good guy over the bad guy. That didn't happen either, did it? Because the chief priests, the religious leaders, were inciting the Jewish crowd. They were going out all among, hey, this guy needs to be crucified. Are you a true Jew? Are you going to really stand with us and make sure this guy is killed? So the Jewish leaders, the chief priests, were driving it. And so compromise number three or whatever it is at that point, Barabbas or Jesus, that failed. And then finally, Pilate gave in to political pressure. And this is the true test of where Pilate stood. Take a look in John chapter 19, verses 7 through 12. And you see the weak will finally winning out. "We have a law," the Jews replied to him, "and according to that law, he ought to die because he made himself the Son of God." When Pilate heard this statement, he was more afraid than ever. He went back into the headquarters and asked Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus did not give him an answer. So Pilate said to him, do you refuse to speak to me? Don't you know that I have the authority to release you and the authority to crucify you?" "You would have no authority over me at all," Jesus answered him, "if it hadn't been given you from above. This is why the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin." Now listen to this, verse 12. Listen well. "From that moment, Pilate kept trying to release him. But the Jews shouted, 'If you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend. Anyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar.'" Now, for me, I have to really rely on the historians to help me understand the depth of what's happening here, because I'm not a Jew, and I didn't live in that time period where the Jews were being occupied by Rome. They hated Rome as much as human beings can hate anyone. They wanted Rome out of the promised land. They wanted to rule it themselves. They hated Rome. And yet, do you hear what these Jews are saying? "We're for Rome. We're for the Caesar. And if you allow anybody to claim himself to be a king, you oppose Caesar too." That's exactly what they're saying. They are taking the side of Rome because they hate Jesus that much. And here's where Pilate's weak will finally crumbles. He hasn't shown any personal strength all along. The whole way he's been violating his conscience, and it's leading to this point where finally when they say, "You know what, we're going to have your position. We're going to have you, buddy. If you allow Jesus to live, we will get you through Caesar." Now, Pilate knows Jesus is not guilty. And yet he's willing to compromise to the point, "You know what? I'm just going to give in to these guys because I don't want to get my superiors angry with me." And admittedly, that was a dangerous thing to do. If you spoke up against Caesar if Caesar didn't like you, it was bad news. Let's just say that's the best way you could put it. It would be bad news. But All along, Pilate knew the right thing, violated his conscience, tried compromises, and finally lived in compromise and violation of what he knew to be right and handed Jesus over. But here's the point that we want to come to, is that it takes courage and confidence to stand for the truth and not compromise. It is not an easy thing to do. I will not stand up here and tell you that when you stand for the truth, when there is opposition, that things are going to work out well. It might not in the short run, in the short term. Because God allows us to experience persecution. He allows us to experience crisis. He allows us to experience suffering. A lot of things that we see only as bad. And when I take a stand against a wrong, I may pay a big penalty for that as far as the world is concerned. I may be suffering seriously for it. So if I'm going to take a stand against what I know to be wrong, despite the circumstances, it takes courage to stand for that truth and not compromise. The thing is, confidence to stand comes when we put the focus on God and His truth and not self. You know, when I look at the situation that I'm being faced with, like Pilate, he had a difficult situation, there's no doubt. He had a lot of opposition and a lot of danger in what he needed to do that day. When we face something like that, when I face something like that, and there's a decision I need to make about a right or a wrong, and if I choose to stand for the right and it's going to be suffering, I need to be looking at God and not me, because when I look at that difficult situation and I'm trying to think through solutions apart from God, the way I can figure it out, the way I can stand against it, I'm going to be overwhelmed. I am not going to see the solution. I'm not going to see the way out. I'm not going to see what God can do if I'm only looking to me and what I can make happen out of the situation. But when I turn it back to God, I'm reminded, you know, this is the same God that for Moses parted the Red Sea, the wall of water on this side, the wall of water on that side, and the whole nation walked through on dry ground. This is the same God that when Elijah was up on top of Mount Carmel, and he just prayed for God to take the sacrifice, God sent fire that didn't simply burn the sacrifice, it burned the wood, it burned the stones, it sucked up all the water. That's my God. If I will look back to God and recognize that's who I serve, it's not just Moses, not just Elijah, not just Peter and Paul. That's the God I serve. And no matter what I'm facing, if I look back to God and not to me, I can have confidence to face that thing. But we cannot give into the fear of what others might think or do. I cannot begin to go there. Let them do what they will do. When I know the truth, when I know God's truth, I simply need to trust in God and stand firm in that truth, regardless of what the outcome is going to be. Because I know ultimately, no matter what I suffer here and now, my God's going to make it right in the end. Absolutely. But God will provide everything we need to stand for His truth. Go with me to James chapter 1. And here in James chapter 1, this passage may seem a little bit different than the typical way you've seen it used, but it fits here beautifully. Take a look, James chapter 1, verses 5 through 8. Here's what James said. He said, "Now, if any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives to all generously and ungrudgingly, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith without doubting, for the doubter is like the surging sea, driven and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord, being double-minded and unstable in all his ways." Do you hear that? "For the doubter is like the surging sea, driven and tossed by the wind." Seems like we started out talking about the wind, didn't we? With the big hot air balloons, and that the wind carries them wherever the wind is going. That is what a weak will is, and that is what this passage is talking about. That if you give in to your weak will, you will violate your conscience, you will make compromises, you will not be able to follow God, you will not be fulfilled and at peace on the inside, and you will be just like the trash floating on the seashore, tossed about by the waves and the wind. You will not be able to stand at all. But what did James say? Actually, what did God say through James is the better way to understand it. If any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives to all generously and ungrudgingly. What that's telling me is, I don't want to be weak-willed. I don't want to be blown around by every wind of doctrine and thinking and ideologies. I want to stand firm in the truth. Now, I struggle with that. I do. We all do. I don't know what is best and right all the time, but I have a promise, an absolute promise here, that if I lack wisdom, all I need to do is go to God and ask for it, and he's going to give it to me. And it's not that he's kind of stingy and he's just going to give a little bit, just enough to get you through. Generously and ungrudgingly are the words right here. That is my God that I'm serving. He wants to help me. He wants to guide me through those difficulties of life. So when I'm facing that crisis and I don't have a clue what to do, my God does. That's who I serve. And that's who I hope you're going to serve too. A weak will. We see it in a violation of conscience and a willingness to compromise. I've seen those things too much in my own life. I don't want it anymore. I want to be better. I hope you will too. So how do we apply this message today? I mean, we've already done some application, but let's take it a little bit deeper. Let's do a few practical things as we wrap it up. How can we change a weak will into a strong will? We talked about what are the results of a weak will. How does it show itself in life? But let's turn that around. What will it look like to have a strong will? What change will that make in my life today? I think we'll see it in attitude and determination. Here are the things to finish up with to apply to our lives. Attitude. Actions always follow attitude. Do you hear that? Actions, what we live out in our life, always follows our attitude, our heart thinking. A strong will stands in absolute trust in God. So if I have that attitude, then I'm just trusting in God. I won't violate my conscience. I won't be willing to make a compromise. I am going to stand for what is truth. So here's the challenge to live out changing the attitudes this week that will change your actions, change how you live if we change the thinking. Every day this week, praise God, whether in good or bad. And I did not miswrite that. That is exactly what I intended. Whether you have a good day or a bad day, in your estimation, praise God. Take a look at Habakkuk 3, 17 through 19. I think you'll see why I'm saying what I am. This is an amazing passage, and we've used it some before, but it's one of those passages that is worth looking at over and over. Though the fig tree does not bud, and there is no fruit on the vines, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no food, though the flocks disappear from the pen and there are no herds in the stalls, yet I will celebrate in the Lord. I will rejoice in the God of my salvation. The Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like those of a deer and enables me to walk on mountain heights. I mean, the writer, Habakkuk, the prophet, saying, if I lose everything, everything I need for this life, I will still praise God. I am still going to praise my God because he's the one, no matter what I'm facing, that's going to make my feet strong. It's going to help me stand firm. I will not be taken down, not because of me, but because of my God. That's powerful stuff. Attitude. That is the kind of attitude that will radically change your life. But then determination, that willingness to keep after it, to endure, to keep working when it's hard. See, having a strong will also depends on an absolute determination to follow God daily. Isaiah 54 through 7 is the last passage I want you to look at today. The Lord God has given me the tongue of those who are instructed to know how to sustain the weary with a word. He awakens me each morning. He awakens my ear to listen like those being instructed. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn back. I gave my back to those who beat me and my cheeks to those who tore out my beard. I did not hide my face from scorn and spitting. The Lord God will help me. Therefore, I have not been humiliated. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know I will not be put to shame. Both of those passages, obviously, I'm sorry, are just powerful passages that are speaking to me today. Our God wants us to stand firm, trusting Him. Our God has promised to never leave us, never forsake us, never let us face a situation alone unless it's by our own choice. We don't have to. This passage was talking about Jesus. It's applied to Jesus later on. That's the attitude he had when he faced the cross. Because he knew, as bad as the cross was, the outcome ultimately was good. We don't have that privilege of seeing the future and knowing how God's going to bring good out of it, out of this bad situation. But we don't need to. We have a God who does see that future, who does see how he's going to work it out. And I can trust him regardless of what's going to happen right now in my life. My God is enough. That is the God I serve. And I hope the God that you will serve. This passage said, Jesus set his face like flint. Flint was that hard stone that was used to strike sparks and start a fire. But it reflects the idea of just absolutely set in stone, confidence, immovable. Set your face like flint this week. Decide to walk each day of your life in obedience and trust. Attitude and determination. A weak will cannot stand against that. Let's pray. Father God, I have no doubt you've been speaking today. You are an amazing God, full of grace and mercy when we don't deserve it, but you give it generously, just like you've promised to give us wisdom generously, and you've promised to help us to stand firm, to set our faces like flint, regardless of what may happen. We can follow you and trust you to be right, and that you will help us to face the problem. Father God, this week, help us to simply love you and trust you with all of our heart. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing a song now, and I'll put my mask back on, and I'm going to step down to the front. If you need some prayer time, come on down and we'll pray. But if God is speaking to you this morning about some failures where you have given in to a weak will, you violated your conscience, or you have made compromises you should have never made, I'll be glad to pray with you about that, for God to give you strength to face the coming days as you should, to give you a return of peace and a purpose in your life. But if you don't know God in a personal relationship and you're here this morning and he's speaking to you, please come down and talk to me, or talk to me after the service. We have a God that loves us beyond anything we can even begin to understand. He loves you. He wants a relationship. And I would be privileged to tell you about that relationship more. But Warren, let's sing. And I'll be at the front if you want to come pray.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchased of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior.
Thank you so much for coming and being part of our service today. Yeah, give me just a minute. This whole day for me has been a powerful day. This morning in my prayer time, I just felt God moving. And just some powerful ways. And I don't know what he's going to do with this message today. But I know we needed to hear this message today. I needed to hear this message today. And each of you at some level, but maybe God's going to use it in some very particular ways. But it, to me, there is nothing that can match knowing God is at work. And this has been one of those days that for me is exceptional. I hope that the message is spoken to you, because my prayer is always that no matter how I do preaching, that's not the important thing. Now, I want to do well, but the important thing is that we hear God speak. And today, our God has spoken. He has given us some things to think about that are powerful things. His truth, though, is always truth. It will never be anything but truth. Time will not change that. Cultures will not change that. Governments will not change that. Our God's truth is truth for eternity. And I want to be like Joshua. You have to make your own decision. But as for me and my house, I'm going to serve God. I'm going to serve Him to the best of my ability. And it's going to be days I'm going to mess up. He's a good God. And I want you to know Him even better than I do. Let me pray to close this out. God, You have been at work here today. And it's not many times I stand up here and so choked up I can hardly talk. But when we're overcome with You and Your goodness, that's an appropriate thing. My prayer today is that this message we have heard will truly be Your message, and that we will be changed by what You have said today, and that we will know there is nothing we will ever face in this world that is beyond our God. You are with us. You have promised to never leave us, never forsake us, to be everything we need. I claim that today for me. And with the authority I have that You've given me as the pastor, the under-shepherd of this congregation, I claim it for these people that are here today and that will hear this message on the internet. You are a God who is worthy of praise and glory and honor. May you receive it today. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for coming today.